Just one by one. So one is Harsh. Okay. Then next, this is Tejas. Okay. Then Sachin Negi. Okay. And one more, Kena. Okay. Okay, for four of you. Okay, guys, meanwhile, we are here. We'll just interact for 10 15 minutes. Yeah, a little bit of mock interview on non-technical aspect. Okay, should we do that? Yes, guys, can you turn on your camera, all of you? Yes,
Okay.
Sachin, Kina. Fair enough. Yes, Tejas, can you share something about yourself? So
So
what we'll
myself.
try to do, we'll do a non-technical interview, a kind of a HR round, and I'll give you a feedback at the end. Okay? It will be
Sure.
very short and crisp. So some basic random questions and some feedback on it. Yeah? Okay.
Sure,
Yes, Tejas.
so myself Tejas Kaikwad. I'm currently doing my master's in artificial intelligence at Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Jodhpur. I have 2 years of roughly 2 years of experience served Reliance Jio as an assistant manager. There I had to work on a packet analysis for the LTE network for the technologies eMBMS, VoLTE, that is voice over LTE network, video over LTE network, and then SIM packets. Then basically the interaction between the SIM and the mobile, and the interaction between the mobile and the base station. So I was required on to analysis all the information or data which is coming from the network to the mobile and which is going from mobile to the network. So yeah, so this was all about my experience. And I did my bachelor's from Maharashtra Institute of Technology, Pune, in electronics and telecommunication engineering. So
Okay.
yeah.
Okay, fair enough. Anything else about you?
So I did my schooling from Kendriya Vidyalaya, as my father was serving in Indian Army. So I was required to like shift almost 7 to 8 kVs all across India. So that thing is there, which has benefited me to acquire the culture as well as to adapt myself more quickly to the new environment, I believe.
Okay, fair enough. Hello, great. Yes, Tejas, can you tell something about your internship project?
Internship project as in for this thing or like for the AI process or for
Yeah,
my
so for
former job?
this MT,
Okay,
MTech curriculum project.
so we have did not had any internship, like official internship going
Yeah.
to the company, but we did lot of mini projects you can say, which were in form of assignment, course assignment as well as course project. So in that let me open my resume so that I can tell you more precisely. So my first
So you talk about Tejas, you do one thing. Just think
yes.
of any one internship project and you can brief on it.
Okay, so recently I worked on multi-agent collaboration simulation for the RoboCup. So RoboCup is basically a competition for AI-based robots which do soccer playing. Okay.
So RoboCop is your college project competition or?
That is one of our post project.
So RoboCop you said, na? This is one of the
Yeah, so
competition.
that was
This
yeah,
is a
RoboCup
college
is one of the
competition
competition.
or what kind of competition it
So
is?
we were asked to perform a small task from a RoboCup competition. Like
Okay.
we chose corner kick event for implementation of multi-agent simulation, like how the agents interact with each other,
Okay.
like for the same team and for the opposite team. So there we were required to develop an environment. There we required to develop algorithms and like policies for the agents to interact among themselves as well as to modify their learning according to the opposition. So for both the teams, like team A and team B, we coded, we designed the algorithm, and like it was performing very like good. So
okay,
that is what I would like to mention that. So this is so similar to this project. There are a number of projects I've done for different domains as well. So let's say one more project I would like to mention about is Trusted AI. So which is in like boom in current AI field. So Trusted AI, basically you must have heard about the deep fakes, you must have heard about the wrong prediction
yes.
of the model. So everything comes under this. Let's say if you give me an image, then I can change a single pixel of your image and make the model predict some other class, because like it is called adversarial attack. So I have done some tasks or projects on that. I've done on some attacks, I've done on detection of these things, I've done on model bias detection and modifying that thing. Yeah, so similar, there are a number of things, a number of domains have done on project.
Okay, that's wonderful. Good then. So, yes, Sachin, over to you. Can you brief something about yourself and your any one project, if it is internship or anything else?
Sir, I'm currently pursuing my MTech in data and computational sciences.
Mm-hmm.
And so for project, I have shifted from mechanical engineering to data and computational sciences. Although I have okay. done, yes, sir, although I have done summer project in Tata Motors, but I will talk about the project which is related to our my current MTech program, that is data and computational sciences. So although I did not do any formal internship, but for the summers for my MTech thesis only, I worked on my MTech thesis is on stock prediction. So I worked a lot on stock prediction, and in this what I tried to do first was to know various technical indicators are those parameters which are used for predicting the stock prices. So
okay.
the aim was very simple, to predict the next day prices based on the historical data. So for that I first analyzed the various technical indicators that are used. For example, we have closing price for a day, then we have opening prices, then throughout the days the volatility.
So what was the outcome of this project?
So till now I have able to gather a lot of information, and I have many ideas, like for example, I can for predicting the next day stock, we can take use of machine learning, but at the same time to measure to predict the next day price, to able to accurately predict the trend, we cannot directly apply the machine model to it. So I have in mind the various things that I will be applying, for the trend we can look up to various technical indicators, as I mentioned previously, and there are other indicators as well which okay. able to tell the trend.
Okay, fair enough, Sachin. I got a little perspective of it. I'll give a feedback at the end to both of you. Okay, fair enough. Guys, you can turn on your camera, don't turn it off. So it would be really engaging session, yeah, and your body language and interaction plays a very important role. Okay, yes. So Amit is there and Saurav is also there. Yeah, hi Amit, I hope am I audible. Yeah, hi Saurav.
Hey Sunny, just give me 2 minutes.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, Saurav, you are there.
Hello sir.
How yes, hi, all good Saurav. It's been a long time while now that we have interacted.
Yes. Yeah,
I hope all good at your home now.
All good.
Okay, good. So fair enough, guys. These are the two people who are there to interact with you, and let me just brief something about Amit and Saurav so that you also get a perspective of who they are and from where they are coming. So I have known Amit for a couple of years now. He was my senior in my school, And later, he did his computer science from RV College of Engineering, Bangalore, in computer science. Then he has done his post-graduation from Great Lakes Institute of Management and Operations Marketing. And later he started working with Cropin Technology. He worked with Fractal Analytics. And he's doing lots of work in the field of analytics, BI, as a data scientist. So huge amount of information he has. And one thing he takes as a religion of educating people and nurturing problem solving with data. So this is what he is into. And parallelly, he is also a founder of Mentor School. So Mentor School, what it does, like it trains people, helps people grow, and help them with those kind of analytical skills. Okay, what decision to be taken, how to be taken. They work on several projects across India. And Saurav is one of his colleague, or say like he is one of the star performer in his team, who is constantly getting groomed. And I've seen him for almost a year now. I've been in touch with him. And this is what the power of having a mentor. So if you have a good mentor, if you have a good instructor with you, with whom you can share your dil ki baat, and you not only grow technically, but emotionally also. And that's what the whole perspective of having a mentor. And this is what Amit is trying to do, or all of us are trying to do. Help people develop a mindset of analytical so that they apply machine learning. They apply tools without critical thinking, without creative thinking. If you're not maturing, if you're not developing, application of coding and all those things is irrelevant. So this is what the whole key area of Amit and Saurav. They visualize the problem as like a kid. Kaise ek 5 saal ka bachcha, 6 saal ka bachcha us problem ko kaise dekhega? So that you understand the thought process and then you start attacking the problem. Yeah, ki agar ek PhD ke mindset se agar problem attack karenge to hum jargon mein phas jayenge. Yes, you will be all more crumbled or get entangled with the jargon. So this is what he is doing, and I love the work he is doing of uncomplicating stuff. So he'll be there with you and whole perspective to all of you. Let's not assume this as an interview. Be a part of it like an interview, but keep on learning. As on a friendly note, if you have anything to learn from him, any queries you have, if you see where you can collaborate in future also, try to learn something from him also. Maybe because the world is very small, yeah? You might help him out in future. You can be a good resource to him also. He can be a good resource to you also. Let's use it as a platform of networking also. And that can only happen when you express. Baat hi nahi karenge to vartalaap kaise hoga? Yeah. And participate karo, baat karo, tabhi to aage rishte banenge. So that's why I end up saying every time, yaar, vilaap se nahi, vartalaap se duniya aage badhti hai. So baatcheet karo aur aage badhte raho. Yeah. Meanwhile, what I'll be doing, so I have a note with me. I'll be observing key elements of a non-verbal part. Okay. How you are answering, were you clear or not? If I'm a third party, am I able to understand you or not? I'll be taking a note of everything, and at the end, I'll give you a feedback. Okay. Good then? Yes. So over to you, Amit and Saurav. Basic structure of this call, Amit, bhaiya, you can give them a small topic to brainstorm. Yeah. Any one thing, let's see what they understand, how they perceive the world. And then you can ask 2, 3, 4 questions one-on-one. Okay. Yeah. And at the end, you can give them a feedback. Is the basics clear or not? What all things they need to do? Because they'll be facing their final placement soon. Yeah. So what they need to fine-tune something. Koi blog padhna hai, koi website padhna hai, anything. Sure. So you can just help them with few tips and techniques.
Sure.
Cool then? Cool to go? Okay. Sure. So Kina, you can turn on your camera. And Harsh, I feel like you are playing Matrix with us. Yeah, aur aisa lag raha hai ki matlab Shri Krishna ya Mahabharat ka episode chal raha hai. So pura color.
Problem with my webcam.
Yes, I understand that. I'm just saying this in a light note. So just trying to see, yeah, if you can fix something, that would be wonderful. Nahi to tum cell phone se bhi login kar sakte ho.
I'll try from cell phones.
Okay, wonderful, Harsh. Yes, over to you, Amit. Saurav.
So, yeah, thanks, Annie, first of all, that wonderful introduction. And I'm so happy to connect with each one of you on this discussion. I would say it's more of a discussion. So nobody is judging you here. So we're trying to, and it's a very good opportunity for me also to connect with people who are still studying. I left it long back, but given an opportunity and given the way the market moves, you are forever a student, actually. So you keep learning every day, whatever the situation may be. And when we say learning, we mostly talk about math or science or code or something, but learning happens in everything. So I'm learning how to be a good parent of a 4-year-old kid, right? So that is also something which I'm learning, and it becomes even more important in this lockdown when your kid is there for 24 hours with you. It brings a whole lot of challenges with itself.
Yes.
So a lot of learning for each one of us for different stages of our lives. So that is one of the philosophies with what we do at Mentor School, is that we are more into technology driven learning, where you guys should learn the skills which will help you take on the next decade in terms of skills. So there are many skills which people had been trying and leveraging to do good in their jobs, but many have started to become old, and many new skills are replacing. So if can I safely assume, Sunny, all of you guys are from having a data or some sort of a background, or is somebody from a different background in the data?
Right. Yeah, Amit, I'll give you a background of all these people. You can see on their names, the bracket names are given. So this is one DCS. So Sachin is from DCS branch.
Okay.
Tejas is AI. Kina is AI. And Hemant was also AI. So three people from AI and one from DCS. All are MT, final year, MTech guys, final year IIT Jodhpur.
Okay, got it. So works well. So then let's think about that we are a team. So Tejas, Kena, and Sachin. So we are a team, and we are here to build something cool. So we heard PM Modi talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat, and all engineers are suddenly very motivated that okay, let's build something. TikTok is gone, so let's build an alternative TikTok, or what else we could do, what we could build, so that it can help solve some problem in the society, right? India actually needs that sort of innovation, where technology has to take the forefront, has to take the lead, where because the scale is huge in terms of expansion. And so resources are limited. So the only thing which can accelerate reachability to services or anything, it could be in education or health or finance or anything, technology is going to be game changer. And you guys being in one of the latest, I would say the field which incorporates the latest tools and technologies to build products and solutions for the next generation. So let's think of that. Okay, we are a team, and we are going to build a technical solution, right? So in that one, suppose first of all, let's think about that what each one of you, first of all, and it will be an individual answer, that what is that one or two problem, and it should not be you should explain what would be the idea behind building something. So first of all, what would be your idea which you would like to develop? And for when you say you have to develop, you will either do it individually. Can you do it individually? Because you'll have to give the entire blueprint of that, right? So I'm not saying okay, you build the product right away, but you have to give a thought. And okay, first of all, what is the idea? What is that one problem it is going to solve, right? And and given the tools, techniques, ideas, concepts, subjects which you have studied, how can that help you build that, maybe a software product or maybe a service? It could be a hardware product, it could be anything, right? So let's take 5 minutes, right, just to think over it. And don't overthink, just whatever first or second thought you get in your head, you can talk about that straight away. Okay, so let's take 5 minutes of that. And let's, this would be first pass. In the first pass, you just talk about your idea briefly, right? And a very brief idea, brief idea of how would you go ahead and develop that. Okay, maybe you can say that I can develop a competitor of Jio, but then I'll ask you, you should get 45,000 crore investment also. Where will you get it from? Okay, so think about it realistically, and let's connect back in 5 minutes to listen to your thoughts. Okay, let's start.
So it's like thinking of all the 5WH, now what, when, how, when, where, whom. Yes. So all those comes as a business plan.
Yes. So first, let's focus more on the idea. Maybe in the second and the third one, we'll try to focus more on concepts and how will you try to do it, the nitty gritties, and then we'll try to deep dive.
Okay, fair enough. That's wonderful.
You can use notebook to write down your notes. You can use notepad if you're in front of a screen. You can make use of all the tools you have at your hand. A quick hint, try to think of concepts, ideas which are more relevant to your field of study, right? Which, because you have to back up with all the ideas and concepts.
Arsh, you joined, so you understood the problem?
No, sir, I wasn't in the call.
Yeah, so please ask, na. If you miss something, please ask. So yes, Harsh, Amit, can you just reiterate this for the Harsh?
Yeah, Harsh. So, one second.
Yes, sir.
Harsh is also AI. Okay. So the question is that you think of a product or solution or anything you want to build as a part of, say, Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative, and what would be that idea you would like to develop based on the skills which you have, which are the skills which you're learning from, right? And what would be the end product which you're going to develop? That is where what we are going to start off with. So let's start off with the idea part. Then you have to back up with the entire plan, and then we will try to deep down in the technology part. So let's start with that.
Yes.
Anyone who feels is ready to go, feel free to ping or speak up. We can start.
Amit sir, I had done a course project based on a fair recommendation. Maybe I am thinking of that this can be done using a Indian point of view.
What recommendation you are talking about?
Fair recommendation based on two-sided platforms.
Okay.
So two-sided platforms, the one side will be consumers and the other side will be producers. Producers, that means, for example, producers means Ubers, it can be Uber driver, drivers, and some recommendation like the recommendation based on will be used in Uber. It will be used in some YouTube kind of thing. Similarly. So we can make that the recommendation should be normally the recommendations will be that consumer should get more benefit from this, and only few producers will be benefited. This will affect the social utility of those producers. There is an algorithm such that we equal amount of equal chances will be given to producers also regarding this, and even consumers will not be losing any interest.
Okay, hold on. Yes. We'll hold on for others' thoughts of what others are thinking, and then we will proceed.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I want to make one point here.
Yes, Sachin.
Sir, like we can, if you are building an alternative of TikTok, then one thing that we should consider is spread of fake news and fake items, whatever we call. So we can use the natural language processing with the help of which by the words we can detect which words are used, which are not appropriate for this platform, and then we can kind of delete that post or that account from which if anything which is not which is not suitable can be removed from that platform. So we can use the NLP to curb these fake news.
Okay. So Sachin wants to take care of fake news with his application, right? Okay. Hold on. Let's hear others also. We have Kena, we have Tejas. Let's hear from them also.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
So I have thought of two ideas basically. So one is related to it, and one is related to a new concept named as federated learning, which Google and Facebook basically uses. So what it has is the model which they have, it is huge. So it requires huge like computation power, and huge complexities are there involved with it. So what they did is breaking that model into a smaller part and predicting for that particular thing, like let's say Google Photos we are having, right? So it basically gets uploaded all the image information if you are having any access, like you have approved the access. So what it does is it gets access of all your information, all your images, and it detects whether the application is based on the face detection. Then it detects the face, then it trains the model. So it requires a huge time, huge involvement of like hardware as well as complexity is also involved. Cost computation is also there. So federated learning, what it does is it basically takes a small part of a model into an application. So what it does is takes the input, let's say an image we are having, takes the input, it predicts something and sends that result to the server. So this is what the concept of federated learning. So my point of view is using this concept to avoid some applications to secretly like steal your data. Right? Like for the image I'm talking about, let's say some applications are there, like Facebook app is there. It have access of your photos and images, whatever you're having. It basically detects the image. It basically detects the background. It checks where you are going. It checks what kind of food stuff you like, etc., etc. So let's say it detects face. It detects whether you're male or female. It detects whether you are ugly or you are like beautiful. According to that, it basically recommends you in advertisements. Over Google or over Facebook itself. So to avoid this thing, not only Facebook, any other application. So to avoid this thing, So what I was thinking was applying some like attack, adversarial attack on the image. Like it will not detect, let's say if it is a face image, it will not detect it as a face image, it will detect some other. So on the basis of this, when the small model which is present on your device, it predicts it wrongly and it sends the information which is false data. So basically your information will not be used like targeted for the targeted advertisements and all, or will not be secretly stealing from your devices. Even, like even if we use any application, we blindly without reading terms and conditions, we click on OK. But if I click on OK, it has some very serious things, serious points. Like they can have access on your phone calls. They can have access on your any data, any critical data which should not be shared, right?
Okay.
So I'm taking example of image. This can be done for any other thing, like text thing is there. Any other thing, right?
Okay.
So this thing is one thing, and then another thing was the COVID project I'm talking about. So this I'm already working on. So what it does is instead of having different like tools to identify your oxygen level, to identify your inner body temperature, to find out suspects whether that person might have COVID or not. Okay. So what we are working on is based on your input, your video input, we are basically estimating whether that particular person is a suspect of COVID or not.
Sure.
So we have some reference papers. If you want, I can share that. So based on for the inner body temperature, we are detecting these teardrops and the area below your nose. So basically, whenever you exhale, that particular temperature differs for the person who is having fever as compared to the normal, okay, as well as the cheeks. And based on the teardrop region itself, we can identify the breath rate as well as the oxygen levels in your body. So that is also one paper. So even from the video input, the heart rate can be calculated. We have that thing. So all those things can be is required only installing a video camera, basically. So the input from it will tell you about the score, will basically tell you about whether that particular person is a suspect of COVID or not.
Okay.
So this can be used when it is not possible to carry a hardware and check each and every person going in front of it by laga le thoda check kar le,
right?
Let's say so just have a like rough idea whether that person might be having like he might be suffering from any fever or any other thing.
Got it. Can we quickly go to others who are still happy to talk about
Kina?
Yeah, Kina.
I think Sachin, Tejas, Harsha have spoken. Yes.
Yeah. Kina is left.
Yeah. Kina, over to you. Kina, are you there?
Hello. Am I audible,
yeah,
sir?
Yes, yes, go ahead.
Kina, can you turn on your camera, please?
Yes, sir. I will like to emphasize on healthcare as Tejas.
You're not audible. You're not audible, Kina. Your voice is coming very low. Can you just...
I'm checking my... Now, am I audible?
Yes, this is better.
Yeah.
I'd also like to emphasize upon healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
So, as we know that we in this COVID times, we all are facing a lack of major platform where doctors and patients can connect, or people might be fighting those might be fighting with their emotional imbalance, can connect with the psychologist, etc. So we have been seeing that we have Uber, Ola, etc. softwares or apps that helps connect the customers with for booking of various hotels, etc. But we do not have such software that connect patients with doctors. So as our government is also now stepping towards one nation, one card concept that will cover all the history of the patient on a single card, so that the patients do not have to carry the files, bunch of files. So we can create such softwares and apps such that we can at least have the district level database where the people who are from higher classes or middle class and lower middle class, everyone may connect with doctors, and they can find the feasible hospitals and the beds, and if they are seeking any other kind of help, they may connect with the people. So that kind of
Okay, yeah, welcome. So thanks for all the ideas, all the good ideas which you all have put up and which you said that you want to implement. We'll pick up just randomly. We'll pick up two of the ideas. One idea is about the fake news detector, which takes into application of NLP, for which I'll have Saurabh ask you some questions on it. And everybody can participate. Doesn't matter that if the project is suggested by person A, that doesn't mean that the rest of you are not talking to. You can contribute, you can answer the questions if the other person is not. So in the end, we are going to think about that as a team. We are going to develop that product. So it's like as a startup, you discussed about 3-4 ideas, right? And then in the end, you just get one idea which everybody agrees to. Okay, so let's begin with some discussion on natural language processing. So the problem statement at hand is detecting fake news, right? So the very first question which I'll have is, what is the problem statement? When you say fake news, news comes in different forms. News comes in the form of video, will come in the form of audio, will come in the form of text, right? Which is like, so what is the goal? Are you are we going to use kind of predict all kind of news forms, or are we focusing on only a specific news form? This was suggested by Harsha, right? Who suggested?
I think Sachin.
Yeah. So Sachin, I think it would be good that you start about defining the problem a little bit more. That okay, we'll be using NLP technique. That's fine. So is it that NLP is the only thing you're going to use? First of all, what is the problem statement you are trying to talk about? So can you be more specific, like a specific use case which you want to solve?
For example, we can say that like what happened at Bangalore, where someone posted an image, and on that image some very indecent comments were posted, and because of that post, it got spread through various social means, and then it led to a lot of riots and all this.
So let's boil this down to, so suppose you want to build a sort of an app which kind of detects whether an image is fake or genuine. Let's keep it to that level. Okay,
and so we can one more point I would like to add, that on time means evaluation, that whether if someone is posting something or someone is commenting something on time, they are able to detect it and remove it as soon as possible. Hello.
Sachin, you're audible. So Amit, are you there? I think some network.
Yeah, I think some broadband issue.
Okay. Yes, so got the point, Sachin. So Saurav, you want to take it ahead?
Yes, Sachin. So the plan is to do some classification sort of thing, right? This is a good news. This is a fake news, right?
Yes, sir. On time classification.
Yeah. On time, someone does something on the platform. Suppose a text or an image, right?
Amit, are we audible now? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So in this one, let's participate and talk about what are the attributes or what are the features you would be interested to extract from this image to help you work towards your goal of building a classifier for a fake versus a genuine image. So think about these features and let me know what would these be, right, which you would consider for your problem.
So I'm not. Okay. I have an idea. Like we have a deep fake detection and tag detection algorithm. Uh-huh. Right now, I'm not aware of. Like I've read it, but I'm not sure about. But these things we are having, so we can use that thing to detect this. If we consider image or video, so we can consider this thing to detect whether it is like perturbed video or image or not. So that thing is there.
So first of all, let's simplify the problem. Let's not go into video, let's not go into audio, let's not go into news item. Picking up only an image. So right now we have, suppose you take a snapshot of the image and they say, is this Sunny, right? Or maybe Sunny has put up a photoshopped image of his. So is this a real image of Sunny or not? If that is the question, right? I'm just picking up image. So what are some of the, if we as a human being, if I look at an image, what are the different aspects of an image I'll be looking into in order to just guess randomly ki ye fake hai ki ye real hai, right? So in layman terms, if you're building a model, they say, okay, I'll feed the image into a model, it is going to give. Of course it is going to give. It's designed to do that. But the features which it is, first of all, when you say, suppose you're looking for an image saying that this image is a boy or a girl, what are the different aspects you look at? You look for long hair, maybe. So, okay, that seems to be a lady. You look for mustache or beard on the face, right? Mm-hmm. That detects whether there's a man or a woman. So these are some of the features which we are looking at for an image. So now when you're saying that you want to detect a fake against a genuine image, then what are the different clues which you're looking for from an image to, first of all, detect whether there is a chance of fakeness or not? So fake is something which I would classify into a sort of a anomaly detection problem, that not every image or video or audio will be fake, but there will be very few. But then you have to pull out from that. In this case, even your sample will be less, right? So first question is, in simple terms, what are and this at this point you need to be very creative in thinking about, okay, when you look at an image, what are the clues classified as fake, right? Let's talk about that first. Think about that and let me know.
If the image is perturbed, let's say a face mapping is done. Sunny sir's face is mapped over some other image. So we can, there are some parameters, face parameters on the basis of which, like Sunny sir's face will be having some score of that face, and that perturbed face will be having different scores, right? Let's say the distance between your two pupils, distance between the eyes to the forehead, the jawline, the distance between two ears, so horizontal distance. So maybe, I'm not sure about it, so I'm just thinking, maybe these parameters might get disturbed when we perturb an image.
So then let's come even one level down, and here let's just talk about an image. That, okay, how do you understand an image? So if you have, say, got it of say cats and dogs. Let's go come down to a very simple data set at cats and dog images. How does the system identify an image that, okay, this image is for cat and that image is for dog, just by giving so many examples of we give so many photos and we have these labeled photos that these are cat photos and these are dog photos, and we supply that to the model and the model starts predicting an unknown image as a cat or dog. How does that happen?
So basically, models learn the parameters, learn the images basically in the batch forms. So it learns the relationship among the batches itself. So whenever a new image comes to the model, it basically divides that particular image into batches and tries to identify. And at the end, it basically formulates score. And if it is in that range, then it is classified as that particular category.
So suppose we are thinking of a model. So okay, so suppose Sunny is our customer and he belongs to a company who wants to use AI technologies in his business, right? And there is a use case of classifying an image, and he has put a set of CCTV camera outside his house, and he wants to always have a notification system that if any unknown person is coming, send a message along with the photo of that person to your mobile and say that, okay, this person is not known to you. Would you like to approve the person's entry or not? So then he can say that yes or no. So how is in this case there is a face detection and face recognition also happening. Both of them are happening. So this question is for Kina. What is the difference between face detection and face recognition?
So face detection means given an image, you want to detect that given the different objects in an image, is there a face or not? And face recognition means we want to particularly recognize the image as to whom this image is. For example, if there is a picture of Amitabh Bachchan, then it must recognize that it's a picture of Amitabh Bachchan.
Right. So given a face, whether that face person that face belongs to which person? So is there a label after recognizing that it is a human face, then whether it is for Amitabh Bachchan or whether it is for Sachin Tendulkar, right?
Yes.
Okay. So then we talked about that, okay, there is a model, and then Sunny asked that, okay, what is this model and all you're talking about? I don't understand this. So how does an image get recognized first? If suppose he asks you that, no, you have to explain me. I cannot go with a very simple overall explanation. So the next question is Harsha. So given an image, and suppose you have not been given any model, right? You do not have any access to any model. Still, you have to pick up that image, and you have to build a model. You have to build a model from scratch to identify whether the image has a face or not. Okay.
Yes.
So we've got examples of say 10,000 images, out of which 5,000 images have human faces, and the other half does not have, and you do not have access to any model. Then how do you start with the process?
We may consider pattern recognition. So in those images which have faces, like the parts of the faces, eyes, nose, they can be clustered, or they can be grouped under one cluster. And those which doesn't have any face, it can be grouped under another cluster, and we can categorize.
That is already done and given to you. So you have been given two folders. One folder is having faces, the other folder is not having faces. Okay. So that example data is already given to you. So now, yes. But what you are not allowed is that you won't be allowed to access any TensorFlow, Keras or all these packages. You have to do it by hand. So to given an image, you have to build a model to recognize whether that is an image, that image is having a face or not. Right.
So there will be labels on
yes.
on this.
Yes, every image has a label now.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
without any models.
There's no model you are using. You have to use only the basic ideas which you have learned in data science or AI, and you have to take an image and try whatever mathematical operations which you have learned, right, to convert this into a model. And that model could be a very, very basic model, first of all, right?
So and we can, sorry. Go ahead. So we can code it from scratch, right? Like for images, CNNs are good. So we can code them from scratch. If we are not going into the complexities, we can simply train a basic neural network model. Let's say 3-layer neural network model. One hidden layer is there, one input and one output is there, and we'll try to like check whether that particular model is able to perform the classification, whether it is a human or not. So this is a binary classification. Okay, and based on that, based on the output of that particular model, we'll try to improve, add something. Let's say kernelization. Let's say convolution.
But I have a simple. The question is for Sachin. I have a simple problem. That okay. I have an image and I have a binary class problem. Face or not. So why can't I use simple logistic regression to solve this problem? And why even think of neural networks, which is so complex and so computationally intensive, right? Why shouldn't we go for logistic regression, Sachin?
Sir, neural network give us more freedom to number of features.
Mm-hmm.
By using neural network, more features can be incorporated. Like if we have large data set, mm-hmm. and means some of them are for example, some of them are human faces and some of them are not. So mm-hmm. Neural network will automatically try to have as many features as much as possible, and mm-hmm. and it will able to better predict for any new data.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that is one of the reason why it should be preferred over logistic regressions.
Logistic regression will be we need to provide features also.
Mm-hmm.
So neural networks will be able to learn the features, whereas mm-hmm. logistic regression we need to provide respective features, so that based on that it would calculate the out curve.
So we are providing the features, right? So when you are having an image, in an image, what does qualify for a feature in an image? If you take an image at the most fundamental level, what in an image qualifies for a dimension or for a what do you call it as feature?
In an image, we can consider features as the edges, the color.
I'm going even lower than this. Yes. At the most fundamental level, how do you identify an image? What is an image at a most fundamental level?
Dimensionality, basically. If it is an RGB, then RGB matrices. Yeah.
Even what is an image at the most base level?
Matrix.
Pixels.
It's a matrix of pixels. Yes. Correct. It's a pixel. It's a matrix of pixels. That's all it is.
Yeah.
Correct. So you take an Excel sheet. In an Excel sheet, you have say 10 columns and you have say 100 rows. So you can have an image of 100 cross 10, right?
Yes.
So 100 rows, 10 columns. So 100 cross 10, right? What would be the size of a 24 megapixel image? These days we capture that a lot. In terms of rows into columns, a 24 megapixel image.
Yeah, so it is approximated 24 into 10 to the power 6 into 3.
That's there. So a 24 megapixel means a 24 into 10 to the power 6. 24 million pixels will be there in that image. We capture the images so casually, and that image has 24 million pixels, which is distributed as a 6,000 rows and 4,000 columns. Right, 6,000 cross 4,000. That's the matrix which is created when you convert that when you read that image using CV2.im read. right?
Yes.
So you have read this image, okay? You have read a huge 24 megapixel image. What will be the next step you will be doing? So you have got two folders of nice 24 megapixel images of people having faces, and the other one with images with no faces. What is the next step you are going to do?
So dimensionality reduction.
Why dimensionality reduction?
So as you said, we have like there is a very large matrix that we have formed because of. So we can reduce the dimension and we have models like SVD and by which we can reduce the dimension but keeping all the important characteristic feature intact.
Okay. So we do dimensionality reduction. What is the reason you said that? Why should we go for dimensionality reduction? If we don't do it, what will happen?
You said that our matrix that is formed, it has large number of rows and columns.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Computationally, it will be difficult.
Yes. Yes.
For that reason, they can go for dimensionality.
So, in terms of process wise, what happens? So, when you have got total 10,000 images, 5,000 into two categories, right? So, you got these images and you picked up all these images and you reduced dimension. You did the dimensionality reduction, right? Okay, you did. And can you highlight a couple of techniques which you would use?
Sir, we have a technique like SVD means I not be able to recall the exact formula, but
that's fine.
Sir, yes, we can use TSNE for this.
Sorry,
TSNE.
Okay. You want to use TSNE ALG also?
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Okay, so you did the dimensionality reduction, done. So now, next, what's the next step?
Normalization or generalization of the pixels ranging from 0 to 1.
Okay, why do we do normalization?
It is the standard distribution of the data. Like all data should be under from a given, should be having a unique this mean and variance from 0. From 0 to 1 and mean should be
so to avoid the false data, basically. Like we have a set of values from ranging from 0 to 100, and we have some values ranging from like 10,000, 20,000.
Yes.
And it is a false data, right? So to avoid that particular thing, we do this.
Yes. So you do normalization because your data may be sensitive to outliers. So when you do your normalization, your data which is more sensitive to outliers, that is also taken care of. So you can you normalize the data, and you can say, okay, I will normalize between -3 to 3, which is using the standard normal distribution. And the second one is maybe min max scalar. You can use the straight away divide by 255. Right, and you get the pixel value. So instead of RGB, that converts into grayscale. Right. So you did this operation. Anything else you do? So dimensionality is done. Your normalization is done. Next step. What next step will you do? Kina.
First of all, I will want to emphasize that for images, using the entire image and giving to the logistic regression task is not preferred practically because it is computationally very time taking, and because the features you want to learn in such millions of there are millions of features, so the weights you want to learn will also be of numbers, so that's computationally not feasible. So we go for convolutional neural networks that automatically learn features, so that the need of manual feature engineering is eradicated.
See, first thing when you said that a logistic regression will be computationally intensive, it's actually otherwise. as soon as you think about neural networks, computational intensity is given. So considering your algorithms, logistic regression actually is going to be computationally simpler compared to if you're looking for neural networks, and especially when you're also going for CNNs.
But sir, that depends on dimensionality of the input, right? Dimensionality is large, then it is preferred that we use deep neural network technique.
Exactly. So the reason for going from logistic regression to say your neural networks is not computation, because computation is going to be complex. You're going to do a linked, or say I would say you're going to perform connected logistic regressions. So the sigmoid function which you are using, that sigmoid function, every sigmoid function is one neuron, right? And these sigmoid functions form one layer, and these sigmoid functions are connected with other sigmoid functions. So it's like a mesh of sigmoid functions, right? And your output is then going to be a zero or a one, which is your final sigmoid function. Correct. So the reason of going from why not logistic regression will work and neural network will work is that logistic regression is first thing first, they are all for solving linear problems, right? So when the problem gets non-linear, where your problem can no longer fit a straight line, you cannot use a straight line to classify your data, you go from linear models to non-linear models. And that's where even an SVM could be a good starting point for this classification. But again, as soon as you move from linear to non-linear models, your model's complexity starts increasing. You'll have to calculate multiple lines and then see a connection of these lines will form a curved line, which is then going to classify your image. Okay. So now we got into the stage of that, okay, we are going to use neural networks, and simple algorithms do not work. And you have normalized the data, you have got, now next step. So once this normalization and standardization, all that step is complete, what would be the next step now?
We can do edge detection.
Before edge detection, are you doing it one by one? You're picking one image. Is it that you're writing a function which will take one image at a time and perform something, then take next image at a time? So what will be the next step? Now you have all the images are standardized. Tejas, you are on mute.
Splitting the data into training and test and validation. Okay.
So what do you remember your MNIST data set? What do you do if you have a 28x28 image? What do you do it? You flatten it first, right?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yeah. So you flatten the images, and suppose you have 10,000 images. So you have 10,000 such rows, which is forming the input vector, which is then fed into your FCN, fully connected network. Right. Yes, go ahead.
So that will be model dependent. Now, what model? What type of model if you are using? If you are using model similar to convolutional neural network, if you want,
I'm not yet into CNN.
I'm just saying it is dependent on model whether we need to flatten the input or not.
Yes. So here I'm just going by the most basic way of first of all doing image detection. Here, what you will understand at the end of the session would be that why CNN, right? CNN did not come before FCN. FCN came before your artificial neuron. That came before fully connected network. Came in after CNN came very late. So it is important to understand why CNN came, and then you have so many variations of CNN, RCNN, mass CNN, blah CNN, whatever, right? But why CNN? Why does CNN comes into the picture at all? So we flattened the image and we put it into like in MNIST. We can flatten the image, put into a vector, throw it into an FCN. It gives a very nice output, right? It gives with a good accuracy. And secondly, I'm still in FCN, right? When you are in FCN, you have what your entire image is nothing but a collection of 784 pixels, correct? Every row. So you have 784 dimensions, and you have one outcome. And all the 784 dimensions, if you are looking for, if suppose you just take a black and white image, so every pixel has just only two values, zero or one, black or white, correct? So this is what you have, and you have fed this into your model. Now, what are some of the parameters which are dependent, which need to be tuned, or which are there available for you to be tuned to ensure a good outcome of your model in a simple FCM?
Maybe number of iterations.
Number of iterations or number of batches or epochs, okay. Mm. What else?
Loading rate,
okay. Mm. What else?
The loss.
Everybody?
Loss function.
Everybody? Loss function, yes.
Regularization.
Regularization function, right.
Optimizing.
Everybody should participate because there are so many parameters that everybody can participate here.
Optimization can be done.
Yes, optimization. So what are some of the optimization functions which you know, which you can use?
We can use ADAM.
Okay.
SGD.
Okay. Why in the MNIST problem statement, what function will you use in the final layer to classify into one of the labels?
MNIST for digit classification.
Yeah, so there are 10 classes, no, from 0 to 9.
So softmax we should use.
Yeah, why should we use softmax there? What is the basis of softmax? For example, we know the basis of sigmoid that it is 1/1 plus e power, mm-hmm. right? Similarly, yes. what's the idea behind softmax?
e raised to power x upon e raised to something like that. Is there? I'm not remembering.
Calculates the ratio of the exponentials, and that's for each of the class, right?
Yes.
Okay. So when you are having more than one category of outcome, you go for softmax, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. And in between the layers, so softmax for the outward layer. Which function is activation function is used recently for in between layers?
ReLU.
What problem does ReLU or TANET solve which sigmoid could not?
So basically, non-negative it passes, and it does not allow the negative values to pass in.
That's true. But why it is said to be better compared to sigmoid function? Somebody said that it is better, and we said, okay, let's go and apply, right? Or is it that there is a reason behind using ReLU?
Sir, it solves the vanishing gradient problem.
Okay, what is that?
So when we apply data to neural network, it's a mm-hmm. continuously learned, but sometimes when, for example, some of the features from some of the features the neural network model has already learned, and from some of the features it is yet to learn, and some of the features has to be weighted less and some of them has to be weighted more. In that task, if it continuously keep updating all the weights, it might land up into some local solution and not the overall minimum function. So that's why we use the variable learning rate, etc.
Okay. Ravi, what is dropout ratio in a neural network? Okay, maybe he's not audible or something. Maybe then, Harsha, would you like to talk about dropout ratio in a neural network?
Dropout ratio, we can say that the neurons which are not active while training, we can remove those neurons so that the computations will become easy and the model will perform better.
But neurons will get active, right? So in a given epoch, a neuron can be activated or it may not be activated. So how do we know that we have to drop these neurons or we have to retain these other neurons?
We can keep a threshold, and based on if the neuron activations are less than that threshold, we can consider it to be not active. So we can eliminate those neurons. So dropout, we can say that we can eliminate those and provide better results. It provides.
Okay. Sachin, one question. So you use a neural network and you are training images. And what would be some of the example of initiation function, initializers? Have you used any initializers, or you have an idea of initializers which you can use before you start your training of your model, your initialization of weights? I think you're on mute.
Hello.
Go ahead, Sachin.
Sir, I think weights can be randomly allotted by time with when the images will be classified. They automatically will be able to reach to its like optimal level. We can in the beginning we can initialize very close to zero as well. I think.
Okay. Anyone else having any idea of other functions?
We can go for transfer learning. So let's say we have a face detection thing. So we can have a pre-trained model on that, and we can use that thing, and we can fine tune it, or we can add some more layers based on our prediction classes, and we can have a, like, it is the best method to get the accuracy, good accuracy, when we have less data as well, and we have a similar like for the image net. It is like lot of images are there, so we cannot use it. We can use that thing, and we can predict similar classes which are available in the image now.
Okay. Have you guys heard of autoencoders?
Yes.
Sir. Can anyone talk about that? What does it do?
So basically, it is similar to the dimensionality reduction with the PCA. It is comparatively PCA. So PCA is works good for the linear functions basically, and it is auto-dev encoders are good for the non-linear functions. It is not that good for the, like, it is not that good for learning the linear thing. Yeah, so basically it is same. It composed of an encoder, decoder, and a hidden layer. So it basically reduces the dimensionality of the input, and then it tries to reconstruct it with the decoder.
Okay. So now we know that we can create a model, we can push that model into a fully connected network, and we put a softmax at the end, we put ReLU in the middle, everything going good, we are getting an output also. Then why get into the headache of learning CNN and applying this CNN? Why do you want to use CNN? Why is CNN, what problem does CNN solve?
Sir, one point is there, like through back propagation in neural network, we can with time it automatically able to means allocate weights and able to means able to classify image better from other algorithms. So I think one of the main feature is back propagation.
Yes, it is there, but this fact back propagation is a fundamental algorithm which is part of FCN also. So why? So first of all, why CNN comes into picture now? So why should, as a deep learning student, you should learn CNN, right? What I fundamentally believe that you don't learn anything until unless you have a problem which is nagging you, and for that you find a solution, right? So why? What problem is CNN solving?
So whatever pre-processing we did with the images earlier. Mm-hmm. Like dimensionality reduction, and then convert it into one dimensional. All these things are not required. What it does is it has some kernel, it has some convolution, it has some pooling. It basically extracts features which are more relevant. Like, it is very good at learning those particular pieces. That's why the CNN comes into picture, and it is good at learning. It is obviously good at signals and imaging. That's why. This is the only reason because of that.
This is one more reason, like you previously also mentioned, like in CNN, we have for every Neuron, we have a separate logistic function. So they come, they are collection of logistic, we can say that CNN is a collection of logistic regression, and which is used for prediction or classification.
Okay. So see, when you suppose when we talked about our 24 megapixel images, right? So when you say, when you just flatten out each image, you got, you get a vector of 24 million columns, correct? If you just flatten it out, which is computationally extremely difficult, because then you have 24 million pixels, and then 24 million pixels is going for each and every neuron which is in between. So FCN means what? That every neuron is connected to every other pixel, right? So it is extremely dense. And second problem happens is because you're flattening out, the spatial correlation between the pixels is going off, right? So where you have a nose and an eye should be together, but when you flatten it out, eyes pixels are gone somewhere else, nose pixels are gone somewhere else. So your images, they are the pixels are spatially correlated. The spatial correlation is something which we cannot lose, because in deep learning, your feature representation, that how do you represent your features, is the whole game. The simplest technique which can help you get the best of the features is what is used. So first of all is the space problem, space and memory problem, computation problem, and second is a spatial correlation problem. Both are getting challenged here. So then what we do is that, okay, instead of learning the image as a whole, we try to learn image in parts, right? For that we bring in a window, and that window slides up on that image, and it uses the principle of convolution, right? Signal convolution, to come up with and these signatures, which are like, okay, what it is going to detect, right? That itself is getting automated. Earlier manual techniques were used, like what was that classifier, Haas or something, so which was used to manually identify, okay, there is a change in gradient, but there can be a nose here or there can be an eyebrows here. But in CNN, when you're using CNN, it is automatically learning smaller components, and then these smaller components combine to make bigger or more complex representations. So edges combine to make an eye, two eyes make the upper part of the face, and then eyes, nose and mouth make the entire face, and then the face is getting detected. So we are going from simple representations, and simple representations combine to become complex representations. But then the next question goes into, what is this average pooling or max pooling in between? What does that do?
Sir, for example, for a particular feature, means it try to extract only those features which are important. In max pooling, for example, we have a matrix, and suppose we have a matrix of 2x2, and each value is 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then max pooling, it picks maximum of those values of that matrix, that is 5, it will pick. So likewise, from the whole matrix, it will try to take the maximum value of each sub-matrix. So it's kind of reducing the dimension.
Okay.
So
any other idea?
One more problem max pooling solve is if we would have classified it in a whole image, for example, the face on the left side corner of the face and the right side corner of the face, the two images would have classified in a different manner. So the spatial takes the image as a spatial invariant. So object spatial location over the image will not bother.
Okay. Fine. So I think we have come to the end of the discussion. So the idea of this discussion was to first of all, when you're presenting your idea that, okay, what is this I'm going to do? Very first thing is that you should summarize in one few lines, that it could be 4 to 5 lines. What is the problem statement? When you start talking in many multiple different directions, right, the main theme gets lost. Okay, what is that idea? Talk about one idea. For example, somebody talked about fake news, like one single line done. Okay, fake news detection. That's it. So the problem statement should be one line. Okay, what is that we are going to solve? How and where and what are the scenarios? That is all for later stages. So whenever you are talking about your idea in front of an investor or a customer or a potential promoter, it should be very clear one line. And secondly, why I ask that, okay, no algorithm, nothing. Why to start from scratch is to open up the idea of, okay, because most of the times we know that there are functions available, there's code available which you can apply and do the job magically. Yes, it does, and it's a huge form of satisfaction. But when you are done with that, you should not stop there. The next point is that, okay, then you take the code out of picture. Because what is code doing? Code is trying to implement some maths, right? And this math came in, this math came first, code came second. It's not that the code came first. Code was built earlier in C, somebody built in Java, somebody is going to build in Julia. The code will keep on changing. But the algorithm, which is actually doing the job, the math, which is doing the job behind, that is not going to change unless there is a fundamental shift in the algo itself, right? So where we try to understand an image, okay, why, what is so special about an image? If we had a table of data, we would have said, okay, logistic regression is so easy, we can use logistic regression. But as soon as somebody talked about an image, you're talking about neural networks. No, why? Can't we do which logistic regression? Because in the end, an image is just a collection of pixels, which can be again represented as a matrix. If I can represent it as a matrix, can't I use logistic regression to solve that problem, right? Or any classification technique to solve that problem, because my input is a matrix and my output is a binary class. So algorithm which can do a binary class problem can fit in. But why neural network? Then we say that, okay, no, the problem here is a non-linear classification. It's not between two classes, and we cannot draw a straight line. The straight line is what we're talking about when we talk about any linear problem solving. The problem here is non-linear, where multiple lines together form a curve, right? And that's how you're trying to classify that, okay, I'm drawing a face, and then in the face, if I'm seeing beard, then I'm saying it's a boy, otherwise it's a girl, right? And then from here, we understand, okay, why or how do we, or why there is a need that from X that you go to a new technique. Why do you want to learn CNN? CNN is very computationally intensive compared to logistic regression. Logistic regression is a very simple problem, a very simple algorithm, right? Why do we go there? So whenever like you're studying anything, and suppose you're going to build a project or you're going to build something, very important idea is a very important step at that point of is that ask hundreds of whys to your problem, right? If every why has an answer and you are satisfied, then you have learned that topic. And once you have learned that topic, then try to have a discussion like this with each other, so that the same idea, three people will have three different responses, and then you can come to a conclusion, and then immediately that becomes useful for each and every person in the group. So that's the power brainstorming brings in. And in that brainstorming, any idea can be discussed, whether it is a technical or a non-technical, right? That doesn't matter, but in the end, it is helping each one of you. Now each one of you can take away some of the ideas which you have discussed, and these ideas has come out from within you itself. I have just been a guide. I've just tried to nag in here and there and try to pick up some of the missing links, right? So I definitely suggest, and especially in this lockdown when we are not meeting each other face to face, to have these kind of connects, pick up a project idea and try to work together. And this is the real time you will be challenged, your concepts will be challenged, your ideas will be challenged. Okay, what I've been thinking and what I've been, say, maybe doing with the Keras, and okay, if Keras is not applicable, if language itself changes, somebody says that please implement this in Julia, how will you be able to do it? Because Julia, still the packages are not there. So you have to write those packages from scratch. And you can write those packages from scratch only when you know the math, know the actual steps behind that, rather than just knowing the keras.fit or something, right? So so thank you for connecting each one of you. Thank you, Sunny. I mean, it was an interesting discussion which I had. And I look forward to more such discussions in future where we can keep on clarifying such ideas and keep on learning something new.
Yeah, so wonderful. Thank you, Amit. That was a very nice of you in helping these kids understand how fundamentals play a very good building block in career, because language will keep on changing, language will keep on upgrading, but the fundamentals will remain the same. How a kid would solve a problem, it will always remain the same because it is unconscious behavior. Yaar ye idhar uthana hai, ye idhar rakhna hai, aise hi karna hai. But you keep on asking him do it in English or French or like Spanish, that's a separate thing. But the way a kid would respond to a problem is a basic logic. And understanding that and questioning that with your constant why, this is what an interviewer looks for. How much ingrained fundamentals are with you? Without technical jargon, how much concepts you have? So that was a wonderful thing there. So Amit, I'll just take 5-10 minutes and give them a one-on-one feedback. Okay. Sure. And at the end, you can also add on how as an interviewer, you see they have performed, if this would have been an interview. So starting with Tejas, I would say you have a very good knowledge on technology and everything. It was coming up, but having lots of topic in your head, it's not coming up clearly. The way Amit has said, if he's asked for one idea, why are you saying two? If he's asking for some problem statement, why this problem statement itself is a big book? Okay. So, but interview, if you are very clear with these terminology in a basic ground level, okay, let's talk about this. Let's explore this with a common language. Yeah. And that's where it comes into a picture. So that's there. And Tejas, most of the time you are referring to your notes on a laptop, I believe. Yeah.
I was writing it down, whatever discussion being taken.
So you said, let me check on the CV or let me check the doubt document.
That was only once. So rest of the time I was noting it down, whatever points.
So, never do that. Never do that, Tejas. Okay. So whatever be it, never communicate that, let me refer to this document or that. Okay. If this is an interview, let's face it as an interview, because most of the time what happens, we are so much connected on digital platform. People who aaj kya hota hai, koi sawal bhi poocho to log turant google karke bata dete hain. Yeah, and you see a pattern in it. Okay, so don't get into that, and that's good. One thing I really liked about you, Tejas, you were taking a lead in driving the conversation. Most of the time when people are not responding, you are there, you are building up stories, you are talking sense. So that's a very good aspect of you and Harsh, I would say. So both of you are constantly adding content, adding data, getting involved, which was not coming up with Kena. Yeah. So Kena, you're getting this point. I'm not sure why it is there, but most of the time, if you recall, Amit had to invite you to talk. Yeah. Amit was not inviting Tejas or Harsha or Sachin to talk. Amit was inviting most of the time Kena to talk. Why? Because if this is a discussion, if you're not participating, if you're not taking initiative, it seems like either you are stuck somewhere or some of the doubts are not getting clarified or you have no content. It becomes a very good big question mark to the interviewer. Getting Kena? Yeah. And it's Kena, am I audible to you?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. And why I'm saying this to you, it is a leadership behavior. Yeah. If you don't get into a practice of this, at the end, kabhi na kabhi phas jaoge. Okay. You never know what kind of a format the interviewer would feel like. He might ask, okay, Kena and Tejas, you get into a debate. He would just sit chatting and he would get you into a debate. But Kena, with these kind of a thought process, you will not be able to perform there. Okay. What if someone is speaking more than you and you have points? You were having very good points, I realize, at some point of a time. But if you're not participating, it becomes a secondary behavior to you. Okay? So please keep on participating. Okay? Good then?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Sachin, do you love singing? Yes, no?
No.
No.
Listening.
No singing. I would straight away suggest this to you, Sachin. Start singing. Because you were speaking words, just words. Ek 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 ek. Can you tell me Jana Gana Mana? Can you recite that? Any of the poem, any of the rhymes of school rhymes, anything, any one poem, nursery rhymes. Can you just speak that? Janagana Mana, Vande Mat, anything which you feel like tumko rata hua hai, and any poem, any nursery rhymes jo tumko rata hua hai.
Not be able to recall that.
Any of the song?
Is it like Janagana Mana Adhinayak Jai Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab the Sindh Gujarat the Ganga
Okay, got this Sachin. So this is a feedback I'm giving to you. Please start practicing. If this cannot be your hobby, it's okay, but practice it. Because tumhare pure jo bhi words ka jo delivery hai na, it is monotonous, it's all flat. Okay, your A to Z is all flat. Whatever you are saying, it's all flat. No emotions, no highs and lows in your communication. Tejas was having highs and lows. Yeah, expressions add ho rahe hain. Tumhare mein it's all flat. Okay, so Sachin, I would really suggest music. What it does, na? Music mein every word has its emotion. Yes, understood, Tejas, what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, every word has emotion. Some words are high paced, some words are low paced. So try practicing that, because your knowledge is not backing out with emotions. तो पता ही नहीं चल रहा है कि तुम कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ बोल रहे हो या ऐसे ही रैंडमली कुछ बोल रहे हो. या अगर तुम्हारा कॉन्फिडेंटली भी आ रहा होगा तो पता नहीं चल रहा है. तो यू आर नॉट एम्फसाइजिंग एनी ऑफ द वर्ड. या आई विल वर्क ऑन फेक न्यूज. कैन यू सी द एम्फसाइज आई एम पुटिंग ऑन फेक न्यूज. ओके, दिस इज वे यू नीड टू एम्फसाइज फ्यू ऑफ द वर्ड्स. आई विल यूज दिस टूल, आई विल यूज दिस टेक्नोलॉजी. व्हाट आई मीन टू से सर, इट कैन बी डन इन दिस पर्टिकुलर वे. कैन यू सी आई एम putting emphasis in few of the words. If you're not putting emphasis, sunne wala fir ekdam hewai ho jayega, lost ho jayega. Yeah, because tumhara pura ekdam flat ja raha hai. Sir, isko aise kar lenge, achha, ye multi-dimensional, okay, ye aise kar lenge. Yeah, it's all flat. So please get into a habit of singing a little bit with highs and lows, thoda sa variation lao. Automatically tumhara emotions ho jayega. And मिरर में देख के थोड़ा सा चेहरा का एक्सप्रेशन करो. एक्सरसाइज इज जॉ लाइन. अंडरस्टूड? एक्सरसाइज दिस, बिकॉज तुम्हारा एक्सप्रेशन कहीं भी नहीं आ रहा है. यू आर ऑल ब्लैंक फेस. ओके, सो एक्सप्रेस विथ योर आईज, आईब्रोज. इफ समवन इज सेइंग, इफ अमित इज आस्किंग क्वेश्चन, इफ तेजस इज सेड, नॉड योर हेड, रेज योर आईब्रोज, या ओपन योर आईज अ लिटिल बिट, स्माइल अ लिटिल बिट. कीप ऑन एक्सप्रेसिंग. जितना ज्यादा एक्सप्रेस करोगे उतना ज्यादा इमोशन कम्युनिकेट होगा. ओके, गुड देन, फेयर एनफ. रेस्ट इट्स ऑल गुड फॉर एवरीवन. यस, अमित, ओवर टू यू. एनीथिंग यू वांट टू ऐड एज एन इंटरव्यूअर?
या सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल एवरीबॉडी पार्टिसिपेटेड, दैट इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग, whether on whether by facing or by dancing. That is something you can control over time. Because some people are naturally inclined towards talking and opening up, and some people they will be like quiet and they'll be mostly sitting in the corner. But in this kind of a situation where you are having a discussion going on, it's natural for the observer to get aligned to people who are talking compared to those who are not. So that's a human tendency that if Tejas is talking the most, I have actually formed an opinion that okay, maybe Tejas is the Tejas may be the best among the lot. So, and this is the perception people will form when you are having this kind of group discussion. So, at times, what happens is you have been taught in a way where somebody will say, "No, you have to speak," and you will say, "Yaar, bolna hai, chalo chalo kuch bol dete," right? Because somebody is asking me to speak up, I just go and speak. That again goes negative. You may put up one or two points in any given discussion, but if those two are solid points and not just fillers, generally there are some people who will say, okay, now let me summarize it. Okay, it's not your job to summarize, that is the coordinator's job to summarize. You'll say, okay, now I think we should do this and this. All these three points have come up from others, you're summarizing. So that goes against you if you're trying to just try to borrow points and try to fill in just because you want to be visible. No, say one or two points, but those 2 points should be your and valid points. Even if you're going wrong, try to speak simple. It's okay to tell wrong thing, right? But it's important that you be very clear, right? Clarity of thought is most important. If you're talking about, okay, if CNN is not used, for FCN. When you say, okay, there is an FCN, is a connected set of networks. Try to, you'll sound much more knowledgeable if you can quote a lot of examples in your answers. So instead of defining a neural network, you can say, okay, let's take an example. Okay, let's suppose there is this one. Because examples tell a lot about that you have actually understood the topic and not just memorized the terms, right? If I say, okay, what is autoencoder? You can say, okay, let's take an example. Okay, so don't even define it. Start with an example. That examples make, first of all, brings down, because it may happen that the interviewer may not always be the person who's a know-all guy. That interviewer may be just a senior guy who's just there to assess not your content, but your delivery. How are you delivering your knowledge, right? And it becomes even more difficult in technology interviews when the concepts themselves are not for everyone. Not everybody can sit and discuss those topics. You need to have a level of knowledge. So you're talking to a person who you are considering to be someone who's much more experienced in that knowledge, but it may not be. The person may be from a different department, but has come in here to just, and especially that will happen when some senior managers, they have come and they're sitting with you. They're actually going to take more like a psychology interview rather than a technology interview. They'll give you some problems, and then they'll just observe if you are fluttering, if you are like stuttering and you are feeling nervous. They'll try to put you in the spot, right? The idea is that even if you have been put into the spot, how do you handle that? And that is a life lesson which you're learning. Even when you get into real world and you are stuck in a project where customer suddenly asks you and you don't know the answer, well, how do you come out of that situation? That is something which maybe I would look at that. Okay, you can say that, okay, I have studied it. As of now, I'm not able to recall, but I have done it. Let me go back and let me come back and discuss. Instead of trying to sound that, okay, I know it all, because then it's natural that out of 10, if you say 2 questions, you don't know. You can plainly say, I'm not aware of this, but I can surely work on it and come back strong on this. So it's a learning from me, right? Try to sound positive, right? Because positivity makes the other person also talk more. If you keep quiet and if say, I also have to, well, then I would say that this person may not be interested at all. Or if this person is not able to speak itself, how can I expect this person to work on a project which will require interaction with the customers? So even if you are, I am naturally an introvert person, right? I will be the last person to talk in a session. But the point is that when you talk, your point should be straightforward, that it's heard by everyone and done. So that is important. And that is different, that is valid. And you have full command over that. So suppose you give a point, and then I hold you, okay, now let's go into deep. You know that, right? So avoid fillers, because fillers are very easily detected, and especially somebody who is a matured interviewer and all, they detect all these fillers which are trying to put in and try to make your way around the interview. So it's better if you say that, okay, I don't know. I actually was caught up in an interview which was a subject which was very deep, which I did not know. And most of the questions I was kind of not getting it. So I straight away said that seems like the interview itself is not a fit. So I think let's not waste each other's time and move out. It's a better discussion, because you are honestly saying that what you are capable of. Okay. And it may happen in today's world when you're going for jobs and you're caught up in a different fit at altogether. So better to just say it out, because not everybody can become good at everything, right? If you are learning deep learning, even if I ask that, okay, why don't you know Excel, right? You'll say, what kind of a question is this? You are asking me something which I don't know at all, right? So straight away say that, no, this is something not my area of interest. These are my areas of interest. If you can ask a question from this, I think I'll be in a better position to talk through it, right? So even when you're talking through to your interviewers about that, confidence, positivity, and humility, that you don't want to use words to sound harsh. So suppose if I'm trying to put pressure on you, right? And I'm seeing it, how this person reacts. Does this person gets agitated? If you get agitated, then that same agitation will come out when you're in pressure situation, right? And in front of customers, if you're getting agitated, getting angry, then it shows that you have a low, you're very low on emotional quotient. Right? So in all such interviews, your technical knowledge, there will be a specific interview round for only tech. There will be a high tech guy who's going to like thrash you out of your concepts and everything. But most of the other interviews, which are other than this, you are, and even in technical interviews, the non-technical aspect, the non-verbal part of it, the way you are sitting, the way you are talking, the way you are using your hands. The usage of hands is very, very useful technique. It actually frees you up. So if you're like kind of sitting like this, no, your body, your posture also talks a lot about that, how much you are content. Even before starting the interview, somebody can know that, okay, this person seems like very, very disturbed. So many times you'll find that even the interviews, they take 5 minutes to settle you down, to make you comfortable. They're okay, chill, calm down, have a glass of water. Now let's talk about yourself. And generally interviews, what will they do is from your story itself, whatever you talk about your CV, they'll pick up points from there itself and they start and get into the interview. So when you introduce yourself, do not make it very long, right? Make it short, highlight the topics and do it deliberately. Highlight the topics which you are most comfortable and talk about them loud. So that the person knows, okay, oh, he talked about CNN. Achha, he talked about backpropagation. Maybe let me ask questions in that topic. Your interviewers, most of the times, your interviewer will be working and somebody will come by, jaake interview lele. He's not in that state of mind to take that interview. But he'll sit into that interview and he'll expect that you throw some words to him and that person then forms some question and asks you back. Most of the times this will happen. So use that opportunity to put your entire CV into say 5 minutes in such a way that you set the stage. You set the stage in such a way that you're basically what's happening is you are driving the entire discussion. You are throwing in the words, you know the best. These are the topics I know the best. The person gets that ideas and starts going deep dive into that. If you do not take that leave and then leave the interviewer to take the lead, then that person can take you to any direction. Then you have lost the control, right? So use some of these techniques and always consider that the person in front of you, if you can research about that person, very good. Even if you don't research about that person, feel comfortable that, okay, you know, the questions being asked will be in this context only. And even if I don't know, be upfront, be humble, be honest, rather than fumbling around and then try. As soon as you fumble, people know, okay, pakda gaya. Okay. So fumbling comes. Jitna fumbling agar kam hota hai na, it is basically you are controlling your own emotions.
Okay.
Yes. Face will become red and you'll start shaking a little bit, you'll start shivering a little bit. So wo sab cheez se samne wale ko dekhega ki maybe you're getting uncomfortable. So if that is a staged interview, like usme it's a stress interview, they will actually try to make it even worse. They'll try to put you into a more stressful situation. A couple of interviews are actually designed, right? But yeah, these mock sessions are basically help you get around all those ideas. And it's more of a game where you have to emerge as winner, not the interviewer. So keep up these points and keep improving your oratory skills, right? And your communication skills. As Sunny says, to come live means the relation will be even more better when you talk face to face. That warmth is there. Otherwise, it becomes okay. It becomes a little unprofessional, especially for an interview. And I don't know whom I am talking to, right? If this person is going to come online for an interview,
so Amit, you're on mute. You got muted.
Oops. Okay.
Yes.
So that's it. I think it was a very good experience for me also. Thank you, Sunny, for this. And I'll be happy to pick up more such discussions in future. Thank you, Saurabh, for being in.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, Amit. So, guys, this is it. So, this was the whole journey. So, Amit, just to update all of you that we had a 5 days of session. Where lots of non-verbal and storytelling and technique of framing your answers we have discussed. And this is what the final closure, how you actually put it into picture, how you actually put it there. So this is what we have done, guys. I would really emphasize on two aspects of our discussion. One is a start technique, how you frame your answers, situation, task, action, and result. Please add on that, because whatever Amit was asking, if you make one lines for each, na, what is the problem? What is the action you're going to take? What could be the actual result? It becomes very easy. So please practice that. And your internship story. So there's a good amount of video and content there. Please create that kind of a stories around it. Okay. Good then. So wonderful, guys. Over to you. How was the day? How was the journey? Maza aaya, nahi aaya, kaisa raha? Batao, bhai.
Sir, I have two questions.
Yeah, teachers.
So basically, अभी हम लोग का लास्ट ईयर में कुछ तीन से चार कोर्सेज हैं अलोंग विद द
क्वेश्चन इज टू होम
फॉर बोथ अमित सर एंड यू सो बेसिकली लाइक माय फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट इज डीप रिइंफोर्समेंट लर्निंग और कॉग्निटिव साइंस और कॉग्निटिव इंटेलिजेंस सो आई विल डेफिनेटली एक्सपेक्ट कि सम कंपनी रिलेटेड टू दिस फील्ड विल कम एंड स्टार्ट रिक्रूटिंग लाइक take placements in our campus, but what if that particular company, that field, the company which is working on such technologies do not come, then how to approach or how to look for such companies, how to approach people from those companies, and
so off-campus placement you are saying?
Yeah, off-campus or yeah. Anyone in your network, let's say tomorrow I'll contact Amit sir, then what is the procedure and what is the like framing to
so,
do?
Fair enough. Tejas, I'll give you a certain aspect of it. I have created one video on networking and relationship building. Have you seen that video?
No, sir.
Okay. That talks about everything of your query. Okay. And have a look. So I'll just sum up what your query is, and then later Amit can also add on. It all talks about what you can give to the company. Yeah. It's not about what you can take, first of all. Let's be very clear of it. So if I'm going as a salesman, I want to sell the object, but exactly what I'm giving to the company. So you need to be very updated of it, and you need to build up a network. So for example, agar Amit is working on certain project, how often you are in touch with Amit? How often you are updating him with your project? How often you are publishing your area of interest? Yeah. What you are working, how often you create a reminder value for yourself in the mindset of Saurav and Amit. Okay. How you create that reminder value? Maybe after 2 months, you publish something on LinkedIn. Okay. Maybe if Amit has posted something on LinkedIn, some problem, you consciously go and like that post, answer that query. You demonstrate your technical knowledge there. You clarify that you are a basic guy. You build a basic relationship, and Amit used a very wonderful word, warmth. Bhai, jab tak warmth nahi hoga relationship mein, technology or technical intellectual aayega hi nahi picture mein. Yeah. So first of all, you need to build up a network relationship. These are the people who can stand for you. These are the people who can vouch for your resume in the company. Most of the jobs after company college placement are all on network and relationship. Got this, Tejas? Pehla naukri to company mein laga diya. कॉलेज ने लगा दिया उसके बाद सारा का सारा जो है मोस्ट ऑफ द 80% 90% जॉब आर रेफरल एंड सीनियर मैनेजर तो पूरा का पूरा रेफरेंस ही फैलता है एंड दिस इज द रेफरेंस इज लाइक एट द राइट टाइम एट द राइट मोमेंट यू आर देयर ऑन द राइट प्लेस एंड वो एडहॉक नहीं हो सकता दैट इज अ रूटीन अच्छा एवरी वीक मैंने ऐसे कंपनी को टैप कर लिया है और उनको फॉलो कर रहा हूँ लिंक्डइन पे उनका कुछ भी पोजिशन पोस्ट आता है तो मैं उसमें कमेंट डाल रहा हूँ उनके एचआर को कॉन्शियसली मैंने टैप करके रखा अपने नेटवर्क में ओके आई एम कनेक्टिंग विद देम आई एम लर्निंग व्हाट एग्जैक्टली दे आर डूइंग आई एम क्रिएटिंग सम काइंड ऑफ अ सॉर्ट एनालिसिस फॉर दिस कंपनी एंड पोस्टिंग इट ऑन लिंक्डइन एंड टैगिंग देम अंडरस्टूड गेटिंग आज के टाइम में एसएसआर टैग करना रिया टैग करना बहुत आसान है सबके लिए हाउ मेनी अ टाइम यू टैग अ गुड आइडिया गुड सजेशंस एंड फ्लिपकार्ट वी डोंट डू दैट इफ फ्लिपकार्ट इज योर ड्रीम कंपनी व्हाई डोंट यू Talk good about Flipkart, give some suggestions, ideas on LinkedIn and tag Flipkart so that you get heard. Okay. You demonstrate your strength. And that's the whole idea of net giving. So Tejas, please watch that video. And one more video is there, New Age cover letter and resume. These two videos are there. Please watch this second video also. It talks about all the 10 tips which you can build up in creating the personal connect. So that tumhara resume to pahunche is company mein, lekin tumhara personal connect established hai wahan par kisi ke saath. Kyunki HR tumhara naam dekh ke to aise hi chhod dega na. HR ko kyun padha hai tumhara resume ka. So off campus is very difficult. How you stand out with your resume, with your cover letter? Can you do some SWOT analysis, pest analysis for the company along with your resume? Can you start working as an employee for that company and you sell yourself? Okay, it's all selling skills. It's all selling skills. And post COVID, Tejas, Sachin, Harsh, is gonna be a very difficult task. Because ek to college mein aise hi company bahut kamane wali hain. Digital mein jiska boom hai, wahi aayega. Core manufacturing to aise bhi kamayega. Okay, and aayega bhi to pata nahi kitna leke jayega, kyun leke jayega. So everybody is under question mark. So aaye chahe nahi aaye, mere ko network to apna increase karna hi hai. And I have seen and I have said this to everyone. For example, you got Amit in your network, Saurav in your network today. Do you have a plan to strengthen your relationship with Saurav and network for another 2 years? This is what it takes, bottom line. You have Sunny Agrawal in your network. Do you have a plan with you? Achha, mere ko ek saal tak, jab tak mera final placement nahi ho jaye, how I create that recall value ki Tejas Gaikwad karke koi hai, Saurav, Amit, Sunny ko ye naam yaad rahe ek saal tak. That is the plan you need to have. Kya karun, kaise karun, kaise network build karun. So identify these 5 people in your network, in the dream company which you want. Achha, mere, agar ye 5 dream company hai, to isme 5 log kaun hai? जो प्रोबेबल इंटरव्यूअर्स हो सकते हैं, जो प्रोबेबल इन्फ्लुएंसर्स हो सकते हैं, हाउ आई क्रिएट दैट नेटवर्क विद देम, ओके, दिस इज व्हाट इट टेक्स, गुड, यस टेक,
सर, हैव यू कंप्लीटेड,
या या, श्योर ना बॉय, नो नो नो, आई वाज डन,
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन वाज लाइक एज आई सेड अर्लियर, आई हैड 2 इयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस प्योरली ऑन टेलीकॉम डोमेन, नाउ आई एम इनटू आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस, सो there are some companies who are working on some interdisciplinary concepts, AI plus telecom. So I recently applied Qualcomm for that. So number of applicants are applying for that position is also less. So that is my plus point. But after joining this program, my interest is like somewhat towards core AI, you can say, like as I said, cognitive AI or deep reinforcement learning. Now I have 2 options, let's say. I join a startup which is working on this such concept, and I join companies like Qualcomm and Intel which are working on such stuff. So which company should I choose and go ahead with?
Tejas, there is no straight answer to this. Okay. It is all about the appetite. Understood? So let me clarify what I mean by appetite. If I am that kind of a guy, if I have that kind of a values or not, entrepreneurial mindset, I can wake up late night, I'm ready to work around, I'm street smart. So agar mere paas is type ka hoga na, it's like comparing 2 companies, Reliance and Tata. Tata mein you cannot be unethical na, you cannot be like process skip nahi kar sakte. Reliance mein I can skip process, I can be street smart. Understood? So you come from Jio background, yeah? So wahan par kya mere ko raato raat result chahiye Jio mein? कुछ भी करो रिजल्ट दो, आई डोंट केयर ऑफ द प्रोसेस, दिस इज अ बेसिक माइंडसेट, ओके, बट इन टाटा प्रोजेक्ट डिले होगा तो भी चलेगा, बट प्रोसेस स्किप नहीं करो, अंडरस्टूड, सो व्हाट काइंड ऑफ अ ह्यूमन बीइंग यू आर, दैट यू नीड टू डिसाइड, अंडरस्टूड, आई एम नॉट क्वेश्चनिंग राइट नाउ, आई एम जस्ट गिविंग यू अ पर्सपेक्टिव, सो स्टार्टअप रिक्वायर्स मल्टी डिसिप्लिनरी बिहेवियर, या कल को तुम्हें सिक्योरिटी गार्ड के लिए भी खड़ा करके बोल दिया ना, तो यू शुड बी feeling proud ki chalo main security guard ke liye bhi aadhe ghante khada ho jaun. This is what startup, because manpower is very crunched, responsibility is very diverse, yeah, tumhe appraisal bhi karna hai, tumhe business knowledge bhi hona chahiye, customer bhi hona chahiye, outspoken hona chahiye, everything comes under startup, okay, and in a structured company it's all about your particular discipline. Kacha mere ko ye knowledge hai, mere ko ye implement karna hai. Understood? So what kind of a appetite you have? If I give you talk about myself, I have a appetite of a entrepreneur, yeah, agar main startup mein kaam karu chahe kahin bhi kaam karu, kahin bhi khada hoke gyan dena hoga de dunga, कोई भी असाइनमेंट मिलेगा तो कर लूंगा, मैं हेजिटेट नहीं करूंगा। कह रहे इसने तो ऑडिट करने के लिए बोल दिया, मैं अपना एआई छोड़ चुका हूँ, 5 दिन से सिर्फ ऑडिट कर रहा हूँ। अंडरस्टूड तेजस? सो इफ यू आर कंफर्टेबल डूइंग ऑडिट, कि भाई अटेंडेंस ऑडिट कर रहे हैं, कितने एम्प्लॉय आए, सैलरी काउंट कर रहे हैं, इफ यू आर एबल टू, इफ यू कैन रिकॉल इन योर लाइफ इंसिडेंसेस वेयर यू आर कंफर्टेबल डूइंग एवरीथिंग, नॉट योर कोर जॉब बट स्टिल यू ड्राइव दैट एनर्जी, देन जॉइन स्टार्टअप, लॉट्स ऑफ लर्निंग इज देयर। या and if you drive energy just from the one source, which is your technical domain, which one aspect, then don't get into startup, okay? Because in startup mein tumko canteen management bhi karna hai, tumko appraisal bhi karna hai, sab kuch karna padega, okay? Good. And startup is more about transactional, bahut data, bahut sab kuch chindi chindi cheez karna padega startup, okay? So I hope this is a two different perspective. So let's know who you are, what kind of environment suits you, then go there. And in current environment, I always say technology mein startup ho chahe hardcore MNC ho, it doesn't matter. It with respect to technology, because startups are ready to fail with respect to technology. Big companies are not ready to fail because they have a huge amount of investment. That's the only difference. स्टार्टअप में तो भाई उनका इन्वेस्टमेंट भी कम है, डेटा भी कम है, टेस्टिंग ज्यादा है, और वो फेल होने के लिए भी तैयार है, दे विल कीप ऑन टेस्टिंग, ओके? सो यू अज्यूम दैट ऑल नॉलेज इन हाउ यू वांट टू अप्लाई, गुड देन, एनीथिंग एल्स? गुड
सर, आई हैव वन क्वेश्चन।
यस
सर, व्हाट द ड्यूरेशन ऑफ मैक्सिमम पॉज वी कैन टेक इफ इंटरव्यूअर इज आस्किंग क्वेश्चन, इज इट गुड और इज इट बैड, जस्ट
तुम अगर 10 सेकंड के लिए भी पॉज लो, इट्स ओके, देयर इज नो इशू ऑन दैट, बट द ओनली पर्सपेक्टिव इज केना, यू नीड टू अर्न इट, अंडरस्टूड? अगर तुमने शुरू में रैपो बिल्ड नहीं किया, शुरू में रिलेशनशिप नहीं बनाया, तो मैं क्यों उतना टाइम दूं? अंडरस्टूड?
यस सर।
सो लेट मी गिव यू अ क्लैरिटी, इट टेक्स जस्ट 10 सेकंड्स टू एलिमिनेट पीपल। अगर मैंने शुरू में 10 मिनट तुम्हें सबको बोल दिया एक एक लाइन बोलो, अब मेरा माइंड सेट हो गया, अच्छा शायद तेजस को हायर करना है या हर्षा को आयश या सचिन को हायर करना है, 10 सेकंड में मेरा माइंड बन गया, ओके? आई बिकम बायस, आई मे बी राइट और रॉन्ग, आई डोंट केयर, but for rest of the 1 hour I'll just be validating. This is how the chemistry lab works, na? You have a basic assumption and just you keep on validating, okay? This is how it works. So it's okay if you want to take pause, but ask a little bit of pointers, okay? So I'm just framing my answer, let me give me a moment, I'm thinking, it's okay, but start, appreciate, yeah, so that's a wonderful question, let me just think for a while, say this, and fair enough, you are done. Have I answered your question, Kina?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, but to earn this, please bridge a rapport, na? Thoda sa interviewer ke saath rapport ban jata hai initial discussion mein. Then you earn the trust, and it's all about warmth. Thoda sa face to face aaye, thoda warmth create hua, thoda relationship bana. Sala main galat jawab bhi de dunga, to interviewer ko fark nahi padega. Wo dekha ki acha, theek hai, banda genuine hai, warmth hai isme, relationship ban raha hai. Okay. So good then, guys. So Amit is here. So thank you so much, Amit. Can you hear to me? Can you hear?
Yes, Ani.
Yes. So Amit, thank you so much. That was a wonderful having you all. And as you rightly mentioned, it's a very long journey for everyone. But the fundamentals are necessity. Because, bhai, कहीं भी चल जाए, basic वही रहेगा. A for apple, A for abacus. But A तो A ही रहेगा. Vocabulary will keep on changing, but alphabets will remain only that only. So that's the whole reality. Again, tomorrow new language, Julia or whatever. So I'm also brushing up all the things. So, mere liye bhi naya concept hai. So thank you so much, guys. Over to you. Can you just give some feedback and some how was the journey and something to Amit? Yes, anyone? All three or four of you. How was your journey? How was the day?
Yeah, how was what all? It was a good offer for us, sir.
Thanks, Acha.
Okay.
So basically, the interaction we had, like I was expecting that interviewer will be going towards the basic or root of the technology. So he must not be expecting high funders or something. You keep, when you join a company, you'll be trained for that, right? But the base thing is whether you know the core concepts on the basis of which the buildup is made. So that is important. So yeah, definitely that thing is there. But yeah, so it was overall nice experience. I liked it.
Okay, chalo, wonderful. Tejas, yeah, Sachin, anything? Yes.
Yeah, yes, sir. Sir, like you said, I have to work on my speaking skill. So definitely I will be working on it. And yeah, Amit sir, like you told, like he was emphasizing on asking more and more questions. So that is one takeaway that I will have, asking more and more questions and working on basics.
That's wonderful. Yes. Yeah. Kina, anything?
The session was very helpful. We learned so much about, so much from Amit sir. Your suggestions also matters a lot. That will help us to improve our step by step. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Wonderful. Chalo, great guys. Thank you so much, Amit, for being here. I always cherish interacting with you. Because at deep down, you emphasize that one point again and again, which we both are working. कि भाई shape up करना है career और next generation तो fundamental से ही करना है. हवा में cloud computing नहीं चलता. हवा में कुछ नहीं होता. It's, you need to have a firm foundation. So right. That's wonderful, Amit. I would request every one of you, please be in touch with Amit. Connect with him. Just see what kind of work he is doing. If you can support him with any of your ideas, suggestion, right. Ask more. Okay, be a net giver. Be a net giver. So watch the video. Be a net giver. See what you can do to him. See what you can do to us. Okay, great then. So wonderful guys. One word each, and you can exit the call. Tejas, Sachin, Kina. One word. How was the day? And you can exit the call. One word. How was your journey? One word. Exit the call.
Fabulous.
Fabulous. Chalo, wonderful, Tejas. Thank you so much. Yes, Sachin.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, great. Learned. Okay, chalo, great. Yes, Kina, one word.
Sir, it would like lifelong learning to keep.
Okay, life. that's the best thing which we can always aspire for. Is something becomes memorable and lifelong learning. So wonderful, Kina. Thank you so much. You can exit the call. Okay.